Shalom, this is Dr. Siva Moodley.
And this is Pastor David Moodley.
And you're watching
Your Miracle Moment.
This has been such an exciting week. Wow.
Yeah.
Awesome stuff. We've been talking about the invisible war on despots. And we haven't even come to the point where we've defined despots.
Yeah.
We've still got a lot more to talk about.
We've been telling you about it, but we didn't define it just yet.
Yeah.
And hopefully this Saturday we'll.
And I know you guys have been blessed by the stuff that you've been hearing. I know many of you have never heard this stuff before.
Yeah.
Never, ever heard a lot of the stuff that we've been sharing on this week. If you missed any episodes, please go back to our YouTube channel and you can watch them there. Also, you can comment there on the YouTube channel and tell us how much you love this program, the effect it's having on your life. And we would like to hear from you. It's important that we hear from you because that encourages us to continue and bring you more stuff like this. You know, this is very abstract stuff that we're teaching.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people don't even know what a despot is, what despotism is. And they don't understand how I'm a Christian. How can a demon attack me? How could my child get sick and I'm serving God? I'm a Christian. And we explained that this week on the program. Mm. It was quite hectic stuff. I shared some personal things that happened in my life and how I used the scripture and I broke the power of the demonic. So even as a Christian, a faithful Christian, demons can still attack you. And how can you stop demons from attacking you? How can you prevent them from attacking you? And in the series, we're going to talk a lot about that. And yesterday on the program, we went quite in-depth to how demonic forces attack Christians.
Open doors.
And what are open doors? How is it that I serve God and still this happens?
Tormented, yeah.
How is that possible that someone is still being tormented by demons for such a long time?
Yeah.
Why are they not delivered? And so we explained that in great detail yesterday. Go to our YouTube, all the episodes from this week, and watch it. And if you want to be part of our global church, you can go to sivamoni.com and join our global church.
Yeah.
If you don't belong to a church and you're saying, hey, I need to come under the covering, I need this kind of revelation and understanding, go to our global church. It's on sivamoni.com/global. Become a member, watch our programs. And you know, the stuff that we shared today on the program, again, it's only 28 minutes. But on our live stream, it goes on for hours, you know, two, three hours.
Explain it properly, yeah. We have a very short amount of time.
Great detail, and people say, it's not enough. It's not enough. We want more, Pastor. So I know you're going to be blessed in our live stream. And the stuff that we teach on live stream is not what we teach on this program, on Your Miracle Moment. The stuff over here and the stuff on live stream is completely different. We've done that on purpose so that people on the live stream can get additional stuff on Your Miracle Moment.
Yeah.
Amen?
Mm. Now, there's different stuff on our new newsletter as well.
There's a new news. Tell them a little bit about that very quickly.
Oh, so the Siva Moodley Ministries official mail. You'll see it on our website if you go there now as well. But we, through direct emails, we are able to say anything candidly. Because thanks to all these problems that like it's happening in the devil is attacking.
In other words, we're able to tell you about what's actually happening in the world.
Yes.
The so attack
much,
on the gospel. Yes.
And that's much more current than, because remember the TV shows are done in advance.
And if the Lord shows us who the Antichrist is, that's
we'll
the place we'll know.
Yeah, you'll
they
let,
won't put
let
it anywhere
you know
else.
On the mails
we'll
only.
Put it there. Right. But there's a lot of stuff that we teach. A lot of my sermons goes there. A lot of my sermon notes goes there in that email system. And it's also designed for people that are not tech savvy.
Yes.
They don't know how to use live streams. They don't know how to use their cell phone maybe.
Yeah.
But here they can read an email. And you can even print out the email for them and give it to them. So you can connect them on the email system. The emails go out regularly every week.
At least a week. There should be more than that.
But at least once, one email a week. And there's a lot of revelation, a lot of teaching. And as I said to you, there's a lot of stuff that we can share on email that we can't just share on a live stream. We can't share on television. Mm. We can't share on social media. Mm. So we share it strictly on those emails. Yes. It's even messages that we don't preach in church.
Yes.
Or even here on Your Miracle Moment. It's not on the live stream. It's completely different stuff that we teach there. It's for a group of audience, a different group of audience, but there's a lot of very deep revelation.
Yeah. And thanks to the technology that's in place, it's a lot faster than the other methods.
Yes.
Like I was saying, the TV episodes are done in advance,
yeah.
and the live streams are done, you know, mainly for the church. But the emails, like, as something happens, we can email you about it and tell
and
you.
And because it's stuff. Email, because yes. it's email, you will always have a copy of
yes,
the message.
Yes, yes, you'll always keep it. Right. So even if, God forbid, something gets knocked out or you get no internet or something, you have a copy of it on your computer.
Go back to it. Yeah. Go back. And you can preach from those messages. You can teach your cell groups from it.
Yes, right? Please.
You can preach from the pulpit. There's the stuff that's been shared over there. Amen. And I know you're going to be blessed by it. Now, I want to go today. We spoke this whole week on Colossians chapter 1. And we went from verses 12 to 16. Today, I want us to go to verse 20. Still Colossians chapter 1. And I want you to read for me Colossians chapter 1, verses 20 to 22.
And God proposed that through him, all things should be completely reconciled back to himself,
right.
whether on earth or in heaven, as through him.
Right.
The Father had made peace by means of the blood of his cross.
Right.
And although you at one time were estranged and alienated from him.
That means you belong, even if you're born in a Christian home.
Yes.
You are not born, you're not born a Christian. There's no such thing as I'm born a Christian.
Yeah.
And there is no such thing.
And read the sixth part.
You have to be born again.
Yeah. And were of hostile attitude of mind.
Right.
In your wicked activities.
That means like, when you are, when you are born as a human, right, as a baby,
yes,
you're born in sin. You can even grow up in a Christian home, but you're still in sin until you make that decision to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior.
And it says you're born with hostile thoughts.
Right.
Like you
want to do wrong.
Yes, yes.
It's natural,
it's
to,
natural
do
to do wrong.
You know, I say it this way. I say, you know, like a little baby, a little toddler, if they go around the lounge and they break a vase right? And then you
broken.
Come in, you say, the vase, my vase is broken. Who broke my vase? And the little toddler says, I don't know. Not me. What is the toddler doing? They're lying. Yeah. But who taught that toddler to lie?
Yeah. Who taught the kid to lie?
Did you say, come, sweetie, today I'm going to teach you how to lie. No, you didn't do that. It came natural to the toddler. Why? Because they're born in sin. It's inside them. The need to do wrong is inside them. That's what the scripture is saying. We're all born with a hostile attitude in our mind to do wicked activities. Yet now,
Christ the Messiah reconciled you to God in the body of his flesh through death in order to present you holy and faultless and irreproachable in the Father's presence.
So now let's look at the first verse 20. It says that God purposed that through him, through Jesus, right? This was the plan of God. This was the desire of God. All things should be completely reconciled back to him. Mm. So Jesus came to reconcile everything, all of us as well. Now listen to this. It goes on because now we're thinking, hey, you know what? This only means, you know, human beings, right? No, read what it says.
All things.
Whether on earth or in heaven, as through Jesus, made peace by means of the blood of the cross. So everything is to be reconciled. So even the things that have gone astray, even if things in the world have gone astray, even financial systems that have gone astray, even if the supernatural, the preaching of the gospel, whatever's gone astray, it's God's plan for all of that to be reconciled to
back to him.
Right? And that's one of the purposes of the blood of Jesus. Amen. Not just us, because the scripture says all things. Mm. Now.
Whether on earth or in heaven.
Whether on earth or in heaven. Come on. Whether on earth or in heaven. You say, but what do you mean in heaven? I mean, people in heaven right now, they belong to Jesus, right? So this is going beyond that. This is talking about everything, all the demonic realm, everything. Of course, you know, demons will never surrender to God. We know that. We know Satan's end, right? But everything that's out there, God wants to bring it back to the kingdom. He's a God of reconciliation, right? That's a loving father, what a loving father does. Now it says the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness are continuously fighting for lives. We were all the property of the kingdom of darkness. Every one of us, even if you grew up in a Christian home, when you were born, you were not born as a Christian. Even though you were in a Christian home, you were never born. There's no such thing as born a Christian, right? Born in a garage doesn't make you a car, right? Born in a stable doesn't make you a horse, right? So none of us are born Christians. We were born hostile. We were part of the pin of darkness. And we may have even given our parents a hard time when we were born. But the moment we came to realization of Jesus Christ, who he is, the plan of salvation, now we had a born-again experience, right? We had a born-again experience. We were the kingdom of darkness, but we now belong to God. And the Bible says that we were delivered when we gave our hearts to Jesus. That's what we read this whole week, that we were delivered and to the point where some of us literally had demons being cast out of us. But we were delivered. And you know, people tell me quite often that when they come to the altar, they say they're so burdened, but they feel so heavy. And the moment they give their life to Jesus, they feel like a weight has come off them. They feel light. So what does that mean? It means you were delivered out of demons, were delivered out of you. That's what it means. The spirit of heaviness was cast out of you when you surrendered to Jesus. Amen. So we all needed deliverance from the kingdom of darkness. I said also this week that we can be children of God. We can love God with our heart. But we can decide, number one, not to surrender to God. And number two, we can open doors, sometimes ignorantly, open doors in our life. And that gives the devil's permissions to attack us. So there are still battles that we are fighting with demons. And for many of us, darkness still has a hold of our minds. You know, Paul said, the thing that I don't want to do, I end up doing, and the thing I want to do, I don't do. Why? Because there's a kingdom of darkness that's ministering to us all the time. It's ministering to us. You know, the thing about a person, every person is a tripod being, right? So they all are spirit beings. They live inside a body, and they possess an intellectual center called the soul. So your soul is your will, your personality. Your soul is what makes you who you are. That's your soul. All your memories, all your intelligence, all your thoughts, all the things that make you react the way you react, that's called your soul. Now, the thing about your spirit and your soul, when you are born again, you are born of a new spirit, man, right? It's regenerated. You have a brand new spirit. However, your soul does not automatically become brand new. Some of the desires have gone away, but your soul is still going through a daily process of being renewed. That's why when David wrote Psalms 23, he said, he restoreth my soul. The word restoreth is a present tense word, means that every day your soul is being restored, renewed. So when someone gets born again, they are not a perfect angel, beloved. They might still have some habits and things that they still hold on to. And maybe it's in ignorance, but they may be doing one or two things that are wrong, and they haven't realized it's wrong yet until they hear the word and the word brings revelation, or until someone ministers them and instructs them and guides them, or the revelation comes to them. When that happens, they realize, woe unto me, I've got to fix this thing, and I am now sinning, and I don't want to sin. I want to put things right in my life. So when someone is born again, they may still have some ways of talking that you're uncomfortable with. They may have some ways of behaving that you're uncomfortable with. Beloved, these are the young ones in the Lord. For you that are mature, you need to guide them. You need to instruct them. You need to bear patience and help them to mature, because their soul is being restored. But during this process, Satan ministers to their minds, right? Many people talk about the mind being the battlefield. So Satan plants thoughts in your minds, and there's a war that goes on in your mind. So you may be someone who loves the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. And then you see someone of the opposite sex, and you have lustful thoughts about them. And you say, I rebuke those thoughts. I rebuke that dream. Right. But the fact is, the devil put it in your mind, and you're a holy person. And the God says, hey, if you're going to ponder over that stuff and you have a problem with your eye, you'd rather pluck out your eye, right? But don't do that literally, please. Don't do that literally. I'm just reading what Jesus said, right? He says, you know what? Don't let the sin keep you out of heaven. Imagine.
Yeah. There was a pastor who said, he said, the first thought is holiness.
Yes.
The second time you think it is demonic.
Amen. There was a pastor that said to me, I admire all these young women. And I said, excuse me, you are a married man. He says, no, I admire the beauty of God's creation. I said, brother, that is lust. Mm. That's a demon that must come out of you. Okay. Yeah, of course, never spoke to me after that again. But anyway, you know, I just say things the way they are. Amen. And I like to say things the way they are because I'm held accountable for everything that I say. So if I'm going to be held accountable, God must put his stamp and say, well done, well done, well done. That's what I want when I get to heaven. Amen. Because you said the right things, right? You didn't hold back. You didn't candy coat it. You said it with love, but you said the right things. Amen. And you said what needs to be told so that people can be set free from bondage. Because only when you hear the truth are you set free from bondage. Now, darkness holds our minds. It holds our marriages. It holds our physical bodies, our soul man, our emotions, captivity. But the kingdom of God is setting us free and has set us free. So some people are still fighting the demons, and even though they belong to Jesus, right? They're born again, but they're still fighting these demons. So the scripture says, remember, whenever the Bible talks about demons, it uses a word. It says, cast out the devil, right? Or draw close to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. Now, whenever it comes to casting out, resisting, it means that there's demonic activity taking place. And when the Bible talks about the battlefield of the mind, it says to cast down those imaginations, those thoughts that the devil has put in. Now, what are those thoughts? They are demonic spirits influencing your thinking.
And they can come from anywhere.
Anywhere. I mean, they're demonic.
Like, yeah, it can be from like a billboard even.
Yes.
And the devil tries everything he can to put into your mind. It says,
right.
You must run the race with perseverance because right. It's so easy to get tripped up and fail.
Right.
And it says that there's a crowd of people in heaven that are watching and waiting for you to make the right decision
yes. And
to avoid the traps that are being thrown everywhere.
So what the scripture is saying, that our loved ones that have departed,
yes,
they are in heaven right now with Jesus.
And they're cheering
right?
us on.
And yeah, you know, and as somebody asked me a question not so long ago, and you can go to my social media postage is there, and you can read my answer. And they said, but the Bible says that absence from the body is presence with the Lord. And then the Bible says that when someone dies in Christ, the dead in Christ will rise first. So where are they right now? And when it talks about the dead in Christ rising first, it's referring to the resurrected body. So the scripture says very clearly, those that are in heaven, those that have died, that are in heaven, they come with Jesus. They only have a spirit and a soul, but they come with Jesus. And as they come with Jesus, when Jesus is returning, the first thing that happens is those that have died, right? Their resurrected bodies go up to meet with the spirit and the soul because they have to now come live on the earth.
Yes.
So they can't live on the earth without a glorified body. Right? They can't live as a spirit. It'll be illegal on the earth. They must have a glorified body. That's why the dead, those that have died, their resurrected bodies go up. So when someone dies, they are in heaven, they're not in the grave. They're not living in the grave. The Bible uses a word. It says, we sleep. What it means by we sleep, it means like, you know, when a person sleeps, their body is on the bed, but their thoughts are somewhere else, right?
Yes.
They live somewhere else.
Yeah.
So this is what it means. When a person dies, their body is in the grave. And again, now remember, a person might have been cremated or their body would have decayed over time. So it's not talking about their physical bodies here. It's talking about a body that they get, the glorified body that meets them as they come from heaven with Jesus because they're changing locations. Mm. You know, we don't live in heaven forever and ever. If somebody said that to you, that's wrong. We live on the earth forever and ever, right? Because we come with Jesus. And then eventually, you know, there's a new heaven, a new earth, and we live and reign on the earth forever. First, we reign for a million years, a millennium. Then after that, it's a new heaven, new earth, and we live on the earth forever with Jesus, right?
Yeah.
But the point I'm going to get here is for you to live on the earth, your loved ones to live on the earth, they'll actually get a new body. Then the Bible says those that are alive, that's you and I, right now we are alive. We immediately move up, and as we are moving up, we don't get a resurrected body. The scripture says our current body changes and becomes an incorruptible body. So the only people that get resurrected bodies are those who are already in heaven.
Yes.
But the bodies are actually the same. This says there's a difference because that body goes to meet them. Our body is changed. Wow. Which means that we if we were to get into the sky, it won't be very far because we're going to come down to the new Jerusalem with Jesus. Amen. Yeah. Now.
Yeah, and right now, before you got into that, they are now watching you and cheering you on.
Yes.
So they're saying like, oh, he drove down this road and then there was like a temptation over there. And they said, look, he avoided the temptation.
So we'll watch this. Yeah. So what you're saying is like someone's granny right now.
Yes.
Right? Is looking down and saying, I hope that boy doesn't fall for that again. Doesn't fall for that girl.
Yeah,
doesn't do that.
Don't eat the Twix. So they are watching and they said they are cheering you on because you have the strength to finish the race.
I'm watching
strong.
My daughter right now.
So they know you can win. Yeah.
They better be going to church because I taught them to go to church. I taught them to be part of the kingdom all this time. Yeah. So they're cheering you on.
Yeah, they're like, don't stay up late watching Netflix or something. They're cheering you on. They're like, oh, you fell for
it. You need to go to church tomorrow morning.
Yeah,
the live stream starts early in the morning. You've got to better go and sleep right now to be in time for that, right?
Yeah. So they cheer you on every day. They're watching to see whether you get entangled, because that's what the word says.
Yeah.
It's like it's an entanglement.
They're watching are you running the race.
Yes, yeah.
So imagine this. Imagine this. Now, this is what the scripture is actually saying, right? It's saying that when you do wrongs, listen to this. This is what the scripture says. And go and read it.
Yeah, you go read it.
When you do wrong, not only does God see it, not only do the devil see it, but those dearly departed also see it. When you make wrong choices,
the cloud of witnesses
watch the wrong choices you make. So everyone's watching you. Oh my God. You know, people say, God is watching me. I mustn't do wrong. No. Everyone is watching you. Those that have died in your home, in your family, your loved ones, they're all watching you. Why? Because they want you to get to heaven. They want you to get to heaven.
It's in Hebrews.
It says,
wherefore seeing we also are encompassed about us with so great a cloud of witnesses. It's a massive cloud. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us or entrap us.
Right.
And let us run with patience the race that is set before us.
Wow. So listen to what I'm saying right now. There is a cloud of witnesses watching you. Mm. And you know, if you have someone that knows you, that was praying for you, that loves you, someone in your bloodline, even someone close to you, they don't have to be in your bloodline, and they've graduated into heaven, they are watching the choices you make. And they are, you know, they obviously can't come down from heaven and tell you, don't do that. Whoa, look at the time. You got to get up for church now. They don't do that. But they watch how you run because they are waiting to see you again. You see, we talk about the loved ones that we miss that have gone to heaven. But the Bible says the ones that are in heaven, they are missing us. And they can't wait for us to come home. So you make sure you get home. You make sure you get home, beloved. Make sure you do everything in your power not to miss heaven. Mm. Now, it's talking here about demon spirits that hold our minds, our thoughts, attack our marriages, physical bodies, because of doors that we open. And there's various ways in which you can open doors. And when you open these doors, one of the ways you can open doors is when you continue to do a certain sin. Mm. The Bible says that through one man, Adam, sin came into the world. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But the Bible says, by one man, sin came into the world and death by sin, which now passed on to all men.
Yeah.
What is death by sin? Is one of the definitions of sickness. The purpose of sickness is to kill you. That's the purpose of sickness, to kill you.
Yeah.
Now, sickness came in because if there was no sickness, now watch this. If there was no sickness, Adam would still be alive. Wow, get this. Every person that was born would still be alive. Mm. They would be hundreds, thousands of years old, but they'll be alive. So the purpose of sickness was to activate the curse. Mm. So sickness brings death. Now, you may not have a sickness that's clearly visible, but sickness attacks your body. It decays your body. So you start to lose vitality. You start to grow old. You start to wrinkle. Your organs, your strength, your energy goes. And all that, that decay in your life is brought about by a certain sickness that erodes your life. So there are certain sicknesses that have been identified by medical science, but there are sicknesses out there that are making you to grow old in your life, to decay. Now, we're not saying, hey, you now need to deal with these things because no one should grow old. No, the Bible does tell us that we do grow old. However, the Bible says that while we grow old, we should not grow old sickly. That means no one should die from a sickness, but they should gracefully grow old, but never die from a sickness, right? Because Jesus Christ took the sickness, he nailed it to the cross. Any sickness in your body is an illegal thing, is a foreign object, right? You know, foreign object, sometimes you could be playing with metal pieces or metal wire, and a piece of wire or maybe a twig gets into your skin, gets into your body. We call that a foreign object, right? It's a foreign object. And now, when sickness enters your body, it is a foreign object. Now, God doesn't teach us to nurse the sickness. He doesn't teach us that. He says, curse it. Mm. Why is it a foreign object, Pastor? Because the medical world told me it's chronic. The medical world told me that I'll live with this the rest of my life, that I've got to accept it. Now, that's what the man says, because the medical world is man. But the wisdom of man is foolishness to a living God. What God says is this. He says, this is a foreign thing in your body. Your sickness is foreign. Your thyroid problem is foreign because it was nailed to the cross over 2,000 years ago. Jesus died on the cross for your healing. Healing, the Bible tells us, clearly is in the atonement. That's why we confess by the wounds of Jesus on the cross, I am healed. Because healing occurred in the atonement. When you take Holy Communion, the communion refers to the cross. Two things happen there. The blood for salvation, the bread for healing. Right? Healing is on the cross. Now, somehow, that sickness was taken off the cross. Somebody went to the cross and they pulled it off the cross and they put it on themselves. And now the foreign object is on them. How did it get there? What brought it there? And so you got to see, what doors did you open? How did you allow the demonic to put sickness on you? And you can go to my teachings on healing. There's a lot of stuff I teach about how sickness comes on a person. But we run out of time right now, and we'll probably have to go continue with it. This is Pastor Siva Moodley.
And Pastor David Moodley.
Reminding you that miracles are normal. God bless you. Bye-bye.